The early 2000s were the era of cyber attacks. And when you look at things from the big picture, this really doesn't come as a surprise. Compounded by a time of political upheaval and division, it was the middle point between the archaic internet of the 90s and the social media boom of the 2010s, a time where the World Wide Web and computers were rapidly advancing and just discovering their true capabilities, a time of experimentation. Everyone had so much power in their hands, even those who shouldn't have had it. Each computer worm or virus that surfaced seemed to one-up the ones that preceded it. And in January of 2004, the world would be introduced to the grandest one of all, the virus to end all viruses, MyDoom, also known as Novarg. Although it spread mostly through email attachments, it quickly became and remains the fastest spreading malware in history. It infected over 500,000 computers in just 1 week and costed $38 billion in damage all around the world. Though the sophistication of MyDoom extends beyond its ability to hijack mail servers, its design allowed it to be quite easily customizable, which quickly led to the creation of multiple variants of the worm. These created backdoors for up to 50 million machines, allowing malicious users direct access to them, and even took down entire websites. And the craziest part? We still don't know who made it. Considering all the computer worms that showed up before it, you would think that by the time MyDoom showed up, people would have learned their lesson at that point. But it was both its unique technological and social engineering that allowed for it to be as destructive as it was and continues to be. You heard that right. MyDoom is still active today, and we're going to talk about why and how it stood out amongst the rest.
Who is this?
Where am I?
More important than where is what? Are you familiar with data brokers, Neo? Those who sell pieces of your information in exchange for money, your favorite clothes, the type of music you like. It is all purely transactional, contained in a database. DeleteMe is a digital service designed to keep your personal info private, as it should be. I have personally used it. All I had to do was fill out my information on my account dashboard. It only takes 7 days to get a full privacy report, showing where and how your info was cleared. They removed my age, phone number, address from search engines. It is all conducted by DeleteMe experts. And it's not just a one-time thing. They do routine scans year-round.
Wow.
This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, Neo. By just visiting the link on the screen, you can get 20% off your DeleteMe consumer plan. Maybe even get a plan for the entire family. That's joindeleteme.com/nationsquid. No, it can't be that cheap. It's not possible. What are you, Neo? Are you with DeleteMe? Or without?
Get me out of here. I want out!
It appears that MyDoom took much of its inspiration from the viruses of the past, both directly and indirectly, and essentially built on top of them, learned from their mistakes. So where did the virus come from? Well, no one actually knows for certain, but we've been able to at least trace it back to a general geographic region. It was somewhere in Russia on January 26, 2004. We know this because the addresses they were traced on used Russian internet service providers, and this was all discovered by a Russian antivirus firm. Sure enough, they were found on email servers, and this is no surprise. After all, the entire purpose of a computer worm is to spread itself and reach as many people as possible. Name a better way to do that than through email, because all you had to do was create a simple macro that would send your malicious file to anyone in the subject's contact list, allowing it to spread exponentially. But now that this was becoming a very common tactic among software developers, they had to get smarter about it. So in addition to MyDoom using email as its main means of spreading, it also took advantage of another popular technology at the time, peer-to-peer file sharing. Now, I've talked about peer-to-peer many times on this channel before, but it was effectively a new way of downloading that was much more secure, much less centralized. You didn't have to rely on the bandwidth of a website hosting the file or worry as much about copyright enforcers taking access to the file down, because all the activity was done privately among individual users. Naturally, a lot of P2P file sharing is used for things like piracy. And when you're illegally downloading content, you're more likely to confront, as well as tolerate, sketchy links and files that may pop up here and there. In fact, a lot of piracy software, such as keygens, are often mislabeled as Trojans by antivirus software, creating something called a false positive. Because of this, it basically became well understood that if you were pirating something, you were taking some risk of potentially downloading something that could trigger your antivirus software to go off. So what does this have to do with MyDoom? Well, MyDoom's secondary mean of transmission was through a, at the time, very popular file sharing service called Kazaa. And of course, this was also peer-to-peer. Basically, MyDoom was able to sneak itself into several files being transmitted through Kazaa at the time. For a piece of malware, this was a very nuanced, almost self-aware take on social engineering, because it is an early example of a virus where the user willingly opens it, knowing there's potential risk involved. It would disguise itself as one of the many files that would show up with a compressed Kazaa download, even in some cases including a fake, lower-quality text file icon. Because false positives are so common with pirate downloads, the user would often knowingly open this suspicious-looking file, assuming that it was nothing more than that, and that the risk would otherwise be minimal. This is actually quite genius, and certainly helped in allowing it to spread so quickly. But it also took another genius approach to this social aspect through the email system itself. MyDoom's starting functionality really isn't all that different from the other email worms. Someone opens an email, there's a file attached to it, and when they open that file, it activates a macro that sends a copy of that file to everyone in your email contacts. Pretty basic at its core, but it's how these emails lured in their targets that made the virus stand out. Worms like I Love You and Melissa manipulated users through positive communication. Oh, a love letter from someone who I know and am close to? I just have to open it and see what it is. A special file attachment meant just for me? I have to see what this is. It creates this feeling that you are special. You are someone to be admired, or an exclusive person being filled in on something most people don't know about. It psychologically allows you to be more vulnerable to opening up, and then the virus just latches onto you. This is pretty much how those "you are the 1 millionth visitor" scams operate, by making you feel special, as if you are about to miss out on something you will never come across again. But MyDoom instead focused on negative communication. People were quickly starting to get cautious of these overly sensationalized emails and better understanding that there was some catch to it. In fact, most recipients of MyDoom even ignored the email for this reason. But what if instead you just replaced their worries with something else to worry about? MyDoom got its users not through flattery, but through urgency. I'm just doing my job, nothing personal, sorry. What? I mean, if someone I know has feelings for me, I could live with not needing to know more. But now my job is at stake? I just gotta see what this is. And then, whether it's through email or Kazaa, the user opens the notepad attachment, and then is confronted with a bunch of garbled text. This was done intentionally to confuse the user into thinking this attachment was corrupt. And then and there, the worm is activated. It sends itself to everyone in your email client's contacts, except for authority and customer support related addresses, such as .gov or admin@customersupport.com, things like that. This artificially increases the credibility of the worm, as you are more likely to get the message from people you know, rather than some random tech support email that would immediately sound off alarm bells. Then it adds a couple little files to your system directory. These operated as backdoors into the victim's computer. Imagine a backdoor as someone trying to break into your house, but since they can't unlock the door, they decide to smash open a window instead. It creates a huge security vulnerability that would allow virtually anyone to access their machine. MyDoom wasn't just a virus in of itself, but also a gateway virus that allowed for other malicious programs to directly sneak in as well, when given the opportunity. And then it did, arguably, the most destructive thing of all. It created something called a botnet. Basically, it took all of these computers that were now infected and had them act as a huge zombie network that would initiate distributed denial of service attacks, or DDoS attack for short. In short, a DDoS attack is when computers send out huge amounts of internet traffic to a website, way beyond the scope of what's normal, and so the website gets overwhelmed and then shuts down. It was programmed to send DDoS attacks to the website of SEO Group just the following week, on February 1st, 2004. Sounds like a bit of a strange website choice for a DDoS attack, but when you start to look deeper into SEO Group's reputation at the time, it starts to make sense. You see, SEO Group was facing a lot of controversy and even legal disputes over their stance on the Linux operating systems, claiming that their system source code was used to create it, and therefore they should own the rights to it, meaning Linux most likely wouldn't be free anymore. Naturally, this pissed a lot of Linux users off, and it was theorized that MyDoom may have even been created as a form of revenge against the company. But oddly enough, this date didn't mean anything, because SEO.com goes down on the very first day of the virus even showing up. And for that reason, the cause of the first crash is actually still unknown. But this didn't stop the SEO Group from getting furious and teaming up with the FBI and Secret Service to try and track down who was responsible, even putting up a $250,000 reward. It was at this point where people began investigating the code to see what else it was capable of doing. And then a McAfee employee saw that the word MyDoom was present in these lines. He thought it would be funny to refer to this as MyDoom, given the horror implications that were to come on the 1st of February. And so the name stuck. Then comes around February 1st. SEO Group's website is completely shut down for over an entire month. It was one of the longest DDoS attacks in history. It got so bad, SEO Group had to register a new domain name and redirect their website to that one until it was all resolved. Then another variant shows up, called MyDoom B. It does effectively the exact same thing, except this one also targets Microsoft's website, scheduled for February 3rd. But fortunately, this variant wasn't programmed as well, and there were a lot of issues that prevented it from spreading or doing as much damage. Also, with Microsoft being one of the most stable websites in the world at that time, they were able to implement security measures against the DDoS attack pretty quickly. So for them, nothing really happened. But nonetheless, they also put up the same monetary reward for anyone who could track down the creator. So if you were on the hunt for the creator of MyDoom back in 2004, you could have earned $500,000. Nice. Soon, many other variants would start popping up, such as ones targeting Google, Alta Vista, maybe even some targeting SEO's new domain name. But since people were already well familiar with MyDoom at this point and it had become national news, these ones ultimately didn't spread as much and therefore didn't cause the same amount of harm. But there's something very weird about MyDoom, and it's that it is programmed to just stop these attacks on February 12th. They were never meant to be permanent, almost as if the creator wasn't trying to cause irreversible harm, but instead send a message. Keep in mind that at this time, a lot of computers had their clocks set back by a couple of weeks, which would allow for the attacks to continue way beyond February 12th. And by the time most of these computers had caught up to that date, the payload wasn't as severe, and so SEO.com was restored. But these back doors still remained, and the actual spreading of the worm never stopped. In fact, MyDoom is still very much alive. It may not be nearly as effective anymore now that Windows has significantly improved over the past decades, but one out of every 100 emails is still infected with it. There was one other thing that was very weird about this worm that may give some leads into where it came from. Some of these emails said, "Andy, I'm just doing my job." Who's Andy? Well, one theory is that this may have been some coordinated cyber attack by not just one person, but an entire organization or government where somebody was paid to create it. Authorities did quickly dismiss this theory, however, as they couldn't find enough evidence to back it up, but MyDoom still remains as one of the greatest and most mysterious viruses in history. We don't know who created it, or why, or what kind of message it was trying to send to all of those who fell victim to it. It's surprising that the fastest growing virus would be just another email worm that most people ignored. But really all it takes is just that handful. And you have to account for all those Kazaa downloads as well. It really is just a testament to how you can truly manipulate the human mind. So how about we go test it out, shall we? So here we are. It is January 31st, 2004, and we are going to activate MyDoom, both through email and Kazaa. As always, this is just a demonstration, not meant to be taken literally, so please do not try this at home. Be safe online. With that said, let's begin. First, let's take a look at our System32 folder. This is where our backdoor is going to appear when we activate the worm, and we will go ahead and do that through our Microsoft Outlook. I've got an important message. Let's go ahead and open that. As you can see, the email client is having a tough time deciphering what this is. Could this be some strange error on my computer? Let's go ahead and download it to know for sure. And there is my document.exe. You can tell right off the bat immediately that this text icon is much lower quality than the real thing, which is an immediate giveaway to the experienced user that something is not quite right. Let's open it. All we get is a bunch of corrupted text done purposefully to confuse the user. And would you look at that? Our backdoor is here, just like that. And of course, it also sent itself to everyone in my contacts. Now let's try it through Kazaa. We'll go ahead and delete this backdoor and open one of our files we downloaded from Kazaa. Again, the same low quality icon. Sure enough, our backdoor has appeared once again, now that I've opened it. It wasn't the thing I intended to download, after all. And now it is midnight, February 1st, 2004. This is the time the payload of our botnet would be activated. Now, one computer obviously isn't enough for MyDoom to take down an entire website, but this is roughly what it would have looked like. I was surfing the net earlier and hopped on to SEO.com. Let's go ahead and refresh it, shall we? Uh-oh. Can't seem to get any signal. Try again. Nope. Nope. That's too bad. Thanks, MyDoom. Well, if you were trying to log on to SEO.com at this time back in 2004 and ran into problems, I was just doing my job. It was nothing personal. I'm sorry. A special thanks to my patrons and channel members for making this video possible. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe and click the notification bell so that you never miss a future video.